When I last talked about Netflix She-Ra, I complimented the show on its characters and character relationships. Obviously, I expected to see more of the same in season 2, but they didn't just double down on the characters as a driving force. They tripled, no, quadrupled down, then sold their house, their car, and their mother to place a big fat bet on mom issues, dad issues, Cat Dora, and Chitin Kitty.
And how did that work out?
Not that great, honestly. But let's get real here. This isn't season 2 of She-Ra. This is episode 14 through 20 of She-Ra season 1.
Just because you call it a season doesn't mean it is, Netflix.
The deformed shut-in of a plot is buried under barrels of drama, shipping bait, and tears.
We call that pulling a Steven Universe.
The connecting thread across the 7-episode season is Hordak trying to build some kind of evil portal. And at least I can finally form an opinion on Etheria's evil overlord. He's okay. I mean, he's way better than the pathetic dope from the original cartoon. And for what he is, he's about as effective as Reboot He-Man's Hordak. Kind of a B to B-plus level bad guy. I like the hints of his otherworldly origin and a possible motivation in the form of a Darth Vader-esque reliance on technology to sustain himself.
He's more machine now than man. Twisted and evil.
Unfortunately, unlike Palpatine's number one enforcer, Hordak has yet to formally establish himself as a clear and present threat to the heroes. He's just the guy ordering the tanks around. So he's more of a Grand Moff Tarkin or Director Krennic. Interestingly, the MVP of Season 2 is Shadow Weaver, whose only episode is the best of the season, and she's probably the most compelling character at this point. She's both sympathetic and reprehensible, mysterious and well-defined, as well as weakened and more dangerous than ever. If you only see one episode in She-Ra Season 2, make it Light Spinner. I was less pleased with the development around Scorpia. She's got some weird romance with Catra.
It's not reciprocated, by the way.
And honestly, it's kind of pathetic. What makes Scorpia work is the juxtaposition of her being a villain, part scary arachnid, built like a Russian powerlifter, and having the personality of the nicest of soccer moms. That's completely thrown off by the needy patheticness of begging for Catra's attention, and it makes the whole enterprise way less fun. I was also underwhelmed by Frosta. In her first appearance, she came off as a no-nonsense hard nose. But first episode of season 2, she's this super enthusiastic wrecking ball. Did I miss something? I get that people act differently at work, but this is like night and day. Who even are you? Another plot point that annoys me is First One's Tech. What even is that?
He keeps getting even more redundant, doesn't he?
They make it sound like the super advanced technology, or magic, of the First Ones is what makes Entrapta's inventions possible. But they use it like an exotic material, like adamantium, vibranium, or pixie dust. Armies fight over it, heroes and villains go on adventures to get it, and they even basically mine it out of the ground. I never get the sense that anyone studies it, or replicates it, or gets ideas from it. Let me give you an example. It's like saying, "Ooh, look, First One's tech, I'll stick it in my robot and then go send it to kill She-Ra." Versus, "Ooh, look, a First One's robot, I'll fix it and then send it to go kill She-Ra." One thing I did like was the length of time the war between the Alliance and the Horde has been going on.
Yeah, that game first came out in 2004.
You shouldn't be able to conquer an area the size of a planet quickly, no matter who you are.
The World Eaters would disagree.
Finally, let's look at the number one thing on She-Ra Season 2's mind, Cat Dora. Look, I'm not a shipper, but clearly a lot of She-Ra fans are, and whether or not it works for you on that level isn't important. It's dragging down the plot, and that's what matters. Both Adora and Catra are spending an inordinate amount of screen time obsessing over each other and their weird love-hate relationship. It's like they're both Helga Pataki obsessing over Arnold. Okay, now it's time to break down the good and the bad in She-Ra Season 2. On the good side, I'm liking the moves they're making with Hordak. Shadow Weaver is just the best at being just the worst. And some of the backstory on Etheria is interesting. On the downside, the season was handicapped from the start by not having a tangible, coherent arc or satisfying conclusion. There's too much time devoted to interpersonal relationships, and the plot contrivance of First One's Tech is lazy. So, unfortunately, I have to give She-Ra Season 2 a 2.5 out of 5. Now, if you're interested in more reviews of anime, movies, TV shows, comic books, or video games, check out my channel right here on YouTube. And find my Facebook and DeviantArt pages for video updates and more. Thank you for watching.
Hey kids, today's show is brought to you by the letter 4 and the number potato! I'm a stupid private.